purpose of this talk is to discuss an agent-based model of the power sector called MLAB generation. And the underlying question really is, well, how are we going to change this huge system to make the energy transition happen? And you can get a glimpse of how huge it really is by looking around me, by looking at these big power plants. And we're now at the port of Rotterdam, and this area here is called the Maasvlakte. Being Dutch, I'm very proud to show you this piece of our land, which was reclaimed from the sea in the 60s, and this is now a flourishing industrial area. But also as a researcher, it's fascinating. It's a huge source of CO2 emissions. It has a few of the newest coal power plants, and it's a huge production center of electricity, but also a consumption area. So how can we get this transition underway? Well, in the previous lecture by Igor Nikolic, you already got to know a bit about agent-based modeling. And agent-based models are a computerized laboratory which help you to explore what goes on here at the Port of Rotterdam, and in particular with the power sector. Because with agent-based models, you don't ignore, but you embrace the complexity of this huge system. So how can we start to understand and shape the system in the direction that we want it to go? How can we get the system to change? We are so keen on reducing these emissions, these CO2 emissions. Well, the things that need to change are right before our eyes here. So as an agent-based modeler, a researcher, I immediately start to think, well, if you want to lower our emissions, we need to change someone's behavior. Well, whose? In what way? To what extent? And how can we achieve that? So maybe we need some policies. So what are the long-term effects of these climate policies that we have? And what model can help you to tackle this problem? So at least you need power plants like these in your model. You need the owners represented. And you have them make them operate, sell electricity, and represent consumption of electricity. So you know when owners choose which power plants to run. And you make sure that they're smart enough to run the cheapest plants. At lower demand, the cheaper plants run, and at peak demand, also the more expensive plants run. And accordingly, electricity prices will vary, and you can explore the results. As of 2005, in Europe, we have an emission trading scheme, which is a market for CO2 credits. So by limiting these credits, CO2 emissions become costly and they're reduced. In order to see the effects of a CO2 price, we added it to this model. And we find that really not much changes in the outcomes. And the cause? Well, we need different kinds of power plants here. So how do those get there? Well, companies need to invest in new generators. So we added the company's ability to make investments. And an investment decision is very much bound by uncertainty. It's based on expected power prices, expected CO2 prices, expected fuel prices, expected technology developments, maybe even the company profile. And in turn, these are at least partly affected by past investments. So all decisions together, all investments together, determine the system-wide developments and its performance. So now we end up with a model, with the existing power plants, the owners that operate them, the market to sell the electricity to, also a CO2 market with limited credits, so you can make sure that there's a CO2 price that reduces the emissions, and the owners that invest in new capacity as they see fit. And with this model, we now study the influence of policy on these investments and in the electricity market, CO2 emissions that result from this, and therefore also the demand for CO2 credits, the CO2 price that results from that, and so on. And with agent-based modeling, this model can explore important aspects like the heterogeneity of actors, the consequences of imperfect expectations, investment behavior outside of ideal conditions. And it's very intuitive. So you can actually see the actors act and interact during the simulation, through the markets, and so on. But the real analysis is done with data of many runs. So what did we find? Well, actually, it's not so straightforward to structurally change the system. As you can see, big stuff, how will it change? And the CO2 market works fine in the very long term, but the very long term. And it's not unlikely that it leads to a rather expensive decarbonization path. So making the energy transition cheaper requires an incentive that is stable enough for businesses to justify significant renewable investments over longer decades. And our modeling suggests that without additional policy interventions, such as a CO2 price floor in the market, this cannot be expected. And Margot Wijnen already mentioned worldwide developments in shale gas have a significant effect on this system, and it makes it difficult to make our electricity sector renewable. can you then say, well, we should not have built a new coal plant here at the first place, at the Maasvlakte? Should we blame the owner, E.ON, for 6 megatons of CO2 emissions per year? Well, not really, because our modeling also indicates that this plant has a reasonable business case, at least when the decision was made. And capturing the most relevant factors underlying investment decisions in the model is really key to embrace the complexity of this system. By doing so, we aim to understand better how the system as a whole functions. We hope to have an impact and to find out where it may be headed. It does not provide you with perfect predictions, but it should help a lot in the discussion on how to make our energy transition going. This modeling is part of TU Delft's Energy Modeling Lab, and it's open source. Do you want to explore it yourself? For more information, go to mlab.tudelft.nl.